General Perkins. He's the TRADOC commander. I could read you his bio, but I would rather tell you a story. General Perkins, during the invasion of Iraq, his classmate, now Lieutenant General Ben Hodges, was my brigade commander in 1st Brigade of the 101st. These two classmates decided that it might be a good idea for his battalion commanders and our battalion commanders to get together one night before the invasion and meet each other on the off chance that we might have to work with each other in the following days, that we really had no idea what to expect when invading Iraq. As luck would have it, we would follow in the wake of the 3rd Infantry Division. The most famous brigade, in my opinion at that time, was the 2nd Brigade, commanded by, at that time, Colonel David Perkins. General Perkins and I linked up outside the city of Najaf, one of the most holiest locations in Shia Islam, what used to be Mesopotamia, the land where Ali came from and where he was buried. If you don't know who Ali is, you should look him up while you're here, but Ali was the grandson and the nephew, excuse me, the son-in-law and nephew of the great prophet Muhammad. And he was buried in the city of Najaf that we suddenly found ourselves attacking. When I pulled up, I was nervous. I hadn't been in any combat at that point, and I saw the battle that was raging outside of Najaf. And just then, an individual inside of a M113 armored personnel carrier, which wouldn't stop a hot stick thrown at it, come rolling up out of the middle of this combat and jumped out of the back of the track, and it was Colonel Perkins. He was bubbly, he was excited, he was inspirational. When I saw him that day, his very persona epitomized what we're talking about this week. He was an inspirational leader. I trusted everything he said, and everything he told me came to fruition, and he was right. He jumped back in his vehicle, and he took off. And what I wanted to do that day was I wanted to make him proud. Eventually, I would end up working for him at Fort Leavenworth, and then now again as the TRADOC commander. Ladies and gentlemen, General David Perkins.
Thanks, Chris. Appreciate it. Go ahead, folks. Sit down. Sit down. I apologize for being a little late. Thanks for about 150-mile-an-hour headwind between Virginia and here, but that just gave you a little bit more time to, I guess, get focused and listen to other folks. Well, first of all, congratulations for being here, because the fact that you're here means that you were selected amongst your peers as standout cadets and somebody that has put a lot of effort into what you've done. You have excelled at sort of everything that's been put in front of you, but more importantly, we think you have great potential to serve our Army and serve our nation. And so at this young point in your military career, you should feel justifiably, I think, proud of what you've accomplished. But also understand that with a level of recognition and accomplishment comes great responsibility. And so then once the Army decides people have potential, we then continue to sort of ramp up our level of expectation. You also can see that the Army puts a lot of effort and importance in this, not only in what you are going to do for the Army, but in general, if you just take a look at the facilities here at Fort Leavenworth, the Command General Staff College and CAC, and the effort that we put in to get you here, the expense of bringing you here and putting this all together, the Army puts leader development and your personal development and your attributes and competencies really at the height of the list of things we do in the Army with regards to importance. There's really nothing we do more importantly in the Army than develop leaders and then therefore give you the tools so that you can develop other leaders. And in fact, that's a couple of things I'm going to talk about today so that you understand kind of where you fit in this big cog called the United States Army. And again, put in perspective, even while you're here, you're going to have as you've already had this week, access to a great number of speakers to get a broad understanding of what's going on, so that when you go back to your schools and or go back and then become commissioned and go out to your platoons and wherever we have you serve, the intent is that you take the tools that we give you here and then put them to work out there. So TRADOC, Training and Doctrine Command, does a lot of things for our Army, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about those. Be happy to answer any questions on it. But one of the things we do is for any problem in the Army, I don't care if it's, hey, we want a new helicopter or we want to design a brigade or whatever it is, TRADOC is charged with coming up with a .mil PF solution, doctrine, organization, training, leader development, material, personnel, facilities, a .mil PF solution. In other words, it's not just, don't go out and just buy a thing, you know, not just get a new bayonet or even just don't build a squad of people. You've got to pull the whole thing together. And in fact, that's how the Army builds capability, is we take people and we take facilities and we take things, we put them into organizations, we develop doctrine for those organizations, and we train people to use organizations, and then we develop the leaders to lead the organization that's been trained. So it's been very useful, and it has proven served us well, that formula. And so when you think about, hey, a .mil PF solution to every problem the Army has, you know, by ordering the alphabet, the first thing is D, doctrine. What is the doctrine? That's not to say that's the first thing we always do, but that's one of the things that I'll talk to you today about. And so if we talk about leadership, which is what you're talking a lot about here this week, and in fact, you've been highlighted as somebody who has great potential to be a leader in the Army, the good news is we in the Army, we have doctrine on it. And it's not too hard to figure out where we keep it, because we keep it in this box right here. Okay? So I refer to this as my favorite box of doctrine. We have really sort of our 14, actually now 15 sort of capstone manuals in here. And they cover the vast array of things that we do in the Army. And we have one that talks about our command philosophy, ADP 60, titled Mission Command. And you're going to be talking about Mission Command. I think General Hughes has mentioned it a bit already. What I'm going to do is kind of give you a one over the world about what Mission Command is, and maybe just as important, what it is not. And then I'm going to take it a step farther and say, well, since we have Mission Command, these are the kind of leaders we need, and therefore this is what you need to focus on. And so I only have a couple of slides, if you put up the first one. So a couple of good things about our doctrine. So when I first came into Training and Doctrine Command and got involved with working on doctrine, I went to, it's here at Leavenworth, Combined Arms Doctrine Directorate, CAD. Went to the guy running at the time, Clint Anker, who's recently retired. He's kind of an institution in himself. And I'm like, okay, so I'm the doctrine guy for the Army now. So how much doctrine do we have out there anyways? You know, it's always a good thing if you get put charge or something, you know, like do an inventory, right? Here's a platoon. How many tanks are in my platoon? How many are Bradley? So, you know, I guess I thought I was going to have to, like, sign for all the doctrine in the Army. So, okay, let's inventory. Get it out there. Let me check it out. He goes, well, sir, right now I think we have 535 field manuals, anywhere from 1 to 300 pages. 100 to 300 pages, 535. I'm thinking, whoa, I'm not sure I've read all that. Well, don't worry, sir, we're going to redo it all. Well, so the good news for you all, because when I came to Command General Staff College as a young major, I still think we had about 400 or 500 of these manuals that were 100 to 300 pages, and we had to go down to a building here on post and get a sizable number of them that went in then the trunk of our car or the back of our pickup truck or whatever, and then would kind of ride around in there. while we went through Command General Staff College to read it. So the good news for you all is that we have sort of reshaped that. And we have gone from 535 manuals to really 14 key ones. Okay, and the guidance is 10 pages or less. So that's a dramatic downscoping of that. And the good news is the first page is generally a picture. Okay, so again, for those of you that may be going armor, this is something you may be able to wade through. And so, again, the good news for that is, well, I have, you know, a 10-page document, of which the first page is really a picture. It's what we call a logic map. It's sort of the Cliff Notes version, if you're still familiar with that paradigm. It's a Cliff Notes version of the whole manual. So if you can't wade through all 10 pages, you know, you can just crank open the Cliff Notes version of it right here. So I say, because I am sure that, you know, wherever you go to school, when you go to your university or college's nightly cocktail party, I know it's just a matter of time till U.S. Army doctrine comes up at the University of X cocktail party. And since they'll find out that you're an outstanding cadet in U.S. Army ROTC, they'll say, well, I'm sure you're the expert on it. And I'm sure the first one that always comes up is Mission Command, especially at the homecoming games. And so if you're going to your college or university's nighttime cocktail party and you don't want to wade through all 10 pages, just turn to the logic map, and it should be enough clarity to get you through that event. But what it really does, as I said, it paints the broad outline of sort of what's in that manual and contextualizes it with the rest of them. So this is a, from the Logic Maccabee ADPO, this is the Mission Command. And so I'm going to sort of talk broadly. Somebody said that they've recorded me once talking about it. They may have played it or something, so it may be a little bit repetitive, but it's important enough that it's good to hear, but then I'll sort of take it to the next level. So Mission Command is the U.S. Army's command philosophy. It's a warfighting function, and it's our command philosophy. So a lot of people say, you know, before you go into command, you need to write out your philosophy and say, well, you know, General Perkins already did it for me. He's already got a book. You know, I don't have to write it. Now, what I would advise people is that you think through how you're going to operationalize it and how do you articulate that to your soldiers. But this is the Army's command philosophy for everybody. All right? As I tell folks, we don't have like ADP 6.0 for like, you know, E3 to E5, then 6.1 from E6 to E9, and then 6.2 for, you know, 01 to 04. It's just one book, just one, you know, 10-page book with one logic map for everybody, from private to general. And then what you do is, within your scope of responsibility, you execute this philosophy. So what is this in essence? Well, I will tell you, there are some misunderstandings about Mission Command. And it really depends upon what spectrum of the age continuum sort of you reside in. So if you're an old soldier like myself, and I talk to retired 3 stars and 4 stars, or other folks, they'll say, well, Dave, it's the same thing as command and control. Because in our doctrine and joint doctrine, there are 6 warfighting functions. The 6th warfighting function used to be command and control, and joint doctrine is still command and control. Our doctrine is completely nested with joint doctrine, except for the 6th warfighting function, which is not command and control. It's Mission Command. So people say, well, it's the same thing. Why'd you do away with command and control and rename it Mission Command? You just need what we call an OER support form bullet. You just need something to make you look good. I said, well, I could use the bullet, but first of all, we didn't do away with command and control. In fact, it's in the manual, and it's underlined in bold, command, control. It's just that command and control is not a philosophy. It is subordinate to that. Because when I was growing up, command and control was the warfighting function. Some could say it was a philosophy. And it's defined as command, issue an order, control, ensure compliance. Okay, I'm going to command you to do something, and then I'm going to control your compliance with my command. And that works if you really absolutely know, if you're the superior headquarters or commander, if you know exactly everything you want your subordinates to do, and then for you just command them, do this, and then I'm going to control your compliance with X, Y, and Z, and then you report your report compliance complete. And that sort of worked sort of in the Army I grew up, because the Army I grew up was really kind of focused on one problem set. And that problem set was the Soviet Union. Okay, so it was a well-defined enemy. It's an enemy that we knew a lot about. It's an enemy that we would continue to learn a lot about. We were going to fight that enemy in a very well-known part of the world, the Central Plains of Europe. No doubt. It wasn't like, well, I wonder if we'll face them in Africa. I wonder if we'll face them, you know, the Far East or something like that. No, it's going to be in one place, Central Plains of Europe, fill the gap, et cetera. And we're going to face them with one coalition, NATO. It's not a coalition of the willing. It's NATO. And it didn't change that much. So therefore, we optimized a philosophy to deal with a known enemy in a known part of the world with a known coalition. And we used command and control, because we knew exactly, well, we had a pretty good idea what that enemy was going to do. They were a pretty regimented enemy. They kind of rehearsed to only do war one way. So you could, with a high degree of surety, predict what was going to happen. And so what we had was, as an army, we had to deal with what I call a known problem. We had to deal with a known problem. Soviet Union, known enemy. Central Plains, Europe, known location. NATO, a known coalition. You had an exquisitely well-known problem. And what we did back then was we took a well-known problem, and then the way we develop people was to learn more and more and more about something that you already know a lot about. So when I came into the Army at the height of the Cold War, like all good armor officers, I was sent to the inter-German border. Back then, we used to have two Germanys, East Germany, West Germany, and patrol along the Iron Curtain. And they said, okay, Perkins, here's what you're going to do, as I date myself. You're going to take your five M60A1 non-rise, non-passive tanks. You're going to dig them in at this 1,500 meters. That's your battle position in our general defense plan. You're going to dig them in, and then you're going to sit there, and then the first Soviet echelon comes over, and you kill them, the second Soviet echelon, the third Soviet echelon. And that's how we're going to prepare you for war. And then what you're going to do is every 90 days, you're going to get in your Jeep, an Army Jeep, no kidding, Jeep, and you'll drive up there, and you'll recon it, and you'll put down the routes through the woods, and if there's any cache of weapons, you'll mark them. If there's any power lines, you're going to take down. And you're going to go over this every 90 days, and then once a year, we're going to rehearse it with a redeployment of forces to Germany, reforgers, and we'll execute our road march tables and pastimes and all that. Because, see, that's how you build an organization to deal with a known problem. If you have a known problem, the way you build an organization to deal with a known problem is you come up with a script, basically, and then you just rehearse it over and over and over again because it's a known problem. And that's how we built our army. Our doctrine was like that. Our leader development processes were like that. Our philosophies were like that. And that's the army I grew up in. Just learn this. We'd have a little deck of cards of enemy vehicles and, you know, kill, no kill, a deck of cards of aircraft, kill, no kill. And we had our battle books that were done in exquisite detail with alcohol pens, fine tip by alcohol pens, everything. Because we knew to a very fine point on that pen exactly what was going to happen. The challenge we have now as we look to the future, if we look in the world right now, we have no idea who the enemy is. We have no idea where you're going to fight them. We have no idea who the coalition is. And it could change. It probably does change constantly. Those of us have served Iraq and Afghanistan, the coalition changes. This country's in, this country's out. NATO wasn't like that. It's not like, well, I'm in on Monday, I'm out on Friday, I rejoin NATO next Thursday. It didn't change for decades. But now, almost daily changes. Caveats, people come, they're part of the coalition. I'm in the coalition, but I can't do this. I can't go outside the water. I can't patrol over here. I can't do this. I can't do that. And it changes with regards to political fortunes, et cetera, like that. And sometimes this person's the enemy, sometimes they're not. Sometimes they're kind of in the enemy, sometimes they're kind of not the enemy. We had no gray zones. If you saw T-72, there was no doubt when I was growing up, that T-72 was bad. Nothing good happened when a platoon of T-72s was headed to you. We have T-72s in NATO now. So we clearly don't have that level of clarity and definition of the problem. And therefore, I told you how we developed Lieutenant Perkins when I came in the Army. Well, there's a Lieutenant Perkins in the Army now. But we can't tell him where he's going to go, when he's going to go there, who's on his side, with the caveats, the ROE. We can't tell him any of that. The only thing I can tell him is you're not going to recon it every 90 days. As a matter of fact, the first time you may see it is when you go there for war. That's a very different world. What's that a world for? That's an unknown world. I grew up building an army to deal with known problems. We've decided that that doesn't work for the future because we don't know what the future holds for us. We don't know what to train you for specifically. So what did I say the Army does when we have a problem? How do we solve problems? .milpf. You have to write new doctrine. You've got to have new organizations. We have to train people differently. We have to have a different leader development philosophy, et cetera, like that. And so that's what we've done. We've written all new doctrine, all of it. We zeroed out all 535 manuals, started from scratch. Never done that before in the Army. Historical level of change. And one of the first ones we wrote is the one, you know what, maybe we ought to start off with how we're going to run this organization. Why don't we start off with that, how we're going to run this thing, and then the details will follow. So this is one of the first ones. In fact, you know, I'll be happy to open criticism, but actually it was the first manual we put out when I became involved in doctrine. So there is a sort of a little ownership for me, but I'd be more than happy to talk about any failings of it. And so what we said was this idea of command and control, that worked for this Lieutenant Perkins, it just doesn't work for Lieutenant Perkins today. Because I'm not sure I know exactly what to command him. What we're going to do is we keep it in the manual, command and control, because eventually we will give commands. And we have to have some method of control, but we balance command and control, not to ensure compliance, but we're balancing command and control to empower the initiative. Because what we want Lieutenant Perkins to do today is not comply, not focusing on compliance with the command, but we want him to seize, retain, and exploit the initiative. Seize, retain, and exploit the initiative. Always. In order to do what? In order to get to a position of relative advantage. Why do you say relative advantage? Why don't you say absolute advantage? Because I just told you everything is changing. Everything is relative. I use a sort of a geographical explanation. If this is a piece of high ground and you're dug in up here and say, well, this, and the bad guys are down here, you say, well, this is a position of advantage. Well, it is today. You say, well, I'm just going to retain this. I'm going to dig in, more sandbags, more overhead cover, something like this. But what if overnight the guys down here signed a coalition treaty with the folks up here? When the sun comes up, where are you? You're in a position of disadvantage. Because it's something you did? No, because the world changed around you and you didn't keep up with it. Because, see, I told you the future that you're going into is a very rapidly changing world. And so we've got to change our doctrine. In other words, whatever you're doing today, even if it works today, there's a temporal nature to it. You might be able to do that same thing tomorrow, and not only does it not work tomorrow, but it puts you in a position of disadvantage. That's why you've always got to be thinking 2 and 3 steps ahead. That's why when you say you're in a position advantage, it's relative, which is why it's not just retain the initiative, it's exploit the initiative. Because if I just retained my position on the hilltop, the next morning I'd be at a position of disadvantage. I have to exploit it. Okay, I'm here today. What might the enemy do? Okay, there's political things. Am I watching those negotiations at whatever level I'm operating on? Hey, he's moving here. Can I cut him off, et cetera? I'm always looking 2 and 3 steps ahead, trying to figure out at the end of the day, where do I need to be? Where do I need to be from a capabilities point of view? If it's a tactical operation, where do I need to be on the ground? But this is a position of relative advantage. I don't care if it's against the Taliban or if you're dealing with Hurricane Sandy, because this is a total army kind of thing. So, in fact, I was just reading an update out at, unfortunately, out in California because of all the rains. That one day, what is it, Lake Orville, I think, and are you from California, that, you know, the spillways eroding away and they're afraid the dam might break. And so the governor's alerted the National Guard to go out there and said, hey, you need to get to a position of relative advantage. That's not the word he said, but what he meant, that, you know, this dam is spillways eroding away and it may break loose. So you, if all of a sudden this torrent of water comes down, what would be advantageous to have? So he said, hey, we need vehicles with high clearance. We got to have sandbags. We got to, in other words, it hasn't happened yet, but we can't wait for it to happen. I need you to get to a position of relative advantage. In this case, it probably is high ground, okay? But if you're going to be able then to exploit the initiative, you probably got to have, you know, inflatable rafts and sort of like that. Have you thought through all this kind of stuff that you have to have? So, see, this command philosophy is not just for fighting the Taliban. It's for dealing with natural disasters. If you're in negotiations in a village someplace trying to pull sides together, what's a position of advantage from a negotiations point of view? It has to do with everything that we do. You've always got to figure out what's a position of advantage, and then how do I take what I have today then to exploit the advantage I have so that I'm always one step in front of everybody else. Well, then you could ask, well, how do you do that? Well, we've got it laid out right here. So sort of the commander slash leader. There's really three things we want you to do. The first one is to drive the process via the six steps of understand, visualize, describe, direct, lead, and assess. Understand the problem. Understand all of the assets. Do you understand, in this case, where the spillway is on the dam? Do you understand what's happening to the hydrology there? Do you understand the towns that are below it if this thing breaks loose? Do you understand, if you're in Afghanistan, who the tribal elders are? Do you understand where 2nd platoon is on one side and 3rd platoon is on the other side? Do you understand the caveats? It's not an absence of caveats. It's not an absence of constraints. People think mission command only works when you are unconstrained. No, it doesn't say that anywhere. It just means you need to understand the constraints, okay? Then once you understand the complexity of the problem and all the players in it, I then need you to visualize how you're going to take whatever assets you have, your platoon, your vehicles, your people, whatever it is, visualize how you're going to pull this all together, and then I need you to describe your visualization such that whoever you're describing it to understands what you want to do, okay? So, you notice it's not understand, visualize, tell. It's understand, visualize, describe. Because understand, visualize, tell would be similar to command and control. I tell you to do something, and then I'll control your compliance with what I told you to do. It's describe. Because when we say describe, it means I have to describe my visualization in a way that you understand, not that I understand. So one of the examples I give folks, if you were in the brigade from the 101st Airborne last year that went to Western Africa to deal with Ebola, and so you're in the 101st Airborne Division and you're in West Africa dealing with Ebola, the way you describe your mission and what you're going to do to 3rd Platoon is probably very different than the way you describe it when in the back of your command post, you know, the World Health Organization walks in, or Doctors Without Borders. Because you're going to have to describe it very differently than how you describe it to 2nd Platoon, because the World Health Organization and Doctors Without Borders, they have a very different way of looking at life. They have a different background. They have a different purpose being there. So this aspect of describing your visualization is very important. And it's actually very powerful, but it's very difficult because you know what that takes to be able to describe your visualization so the person you talk to understands it? You have to understand how they look at life. You have to understand their background, et cetera, like that. Then we want you to direct, lead, and assess. Then you start directing people what to do. Then you lead from the front. Then you do an assessment, et cetera. So I told you there's sort of two big misunderstandings. The first one is It's the same thing as mission command. No, it's not. It's the same thing as command and control. It's very, very different. It's very, very different. It's overarching philosophy of which you balance command and control, again, to empower the initiative. You don't control initiative. You empower initiative. And then the other thing is, so sort of for people at my end of the age spectrum, say, well, Dave, it's the same thing as command and control. No, sir, it's not. Sometimes the feedback I get from people at the other end, maybe the end that you're more familiar with, say, well, you know, mission command, that means, first of all, I don't think, you know, and I read blogs of this and headlines, you know, the Army can't handle mission command. The Army can't handle it because, you know, generals, you know, they're micromanagers. They want to let go of stuff. There's zero defect. Because the scene is that mission command equates to, well, you can't tell me what to do. If you have mission command, you can't have mandatory training. You can't check on me or whatever. And you basically can't tell me what to do. And so as being one of the primary authors of this, I'm like, you know what? I don't see the fourth bullet, don't tell anyone what to do. So mission command has nothing to do with not being able to tell anybody what to do. As a matter of fact, as I tell folks, understand, visualize, describe, direct. Direct, not mildly recommend, direct. Okay, so I say, Lieutenant, we're going to direct you to do a lot. Lieutenant General, I'm going to direct you to do a lot. It's just that we don't give directions until we understand, visualize, and describe. That's the big difference. Do you have everyone on the same sheet of music? Do you understand the purpose of what we're doing? Do you understand where we're going? Once we do all that, then you give direction, but you give direction such that it is empowering versus constraining, okay? Then you lead and assess. That's a very difficult way to run an organization, any organization. Really difficult way to run the Army. 1.2 million person organization in 160 countries of the world. That's a really hard way to run an Army. The main reason is because if you want to run an organization like this, you have to have a very well-trained, well-disciplined, well-led organization. Because if you have an organization that is not well-trained, that is ill-disciplined and not well-led, are you going to empower that organization? No. What are you going to do? You're going to control it. My experience is I travel around the world and work with other armies and other organizations. The less professional and less disciplined the organization is, the more you control it. In fact, I even see that in the American Army. When I walk into an organization, and I've spent a lot of time across the whole Army and been in the Army a long time, so when I walk into an organization, give me 5 or 10 minutes. And I can tell you whether that is an empowered organization or a highly controlled organization. I can tell by the way people interact. I can tell how they talk about things, et cetera, like that. And in my mind, it's a direct reflection on the leadership of that organization. If it is a highly controlled organization, overly controlled, all organizations have to be controlled, but if it's overly controlled, focusing on compliance, that means either it is an organization of ill-trained, ill-disciplined people, or it's not well-led. When you walk into an organization that's an empowered organization, it's generally very well-led, and it's generally an organization of very disciplined, well-trained people. So if you decide, well, I'm going to run my whole organization, the whole United States Army, we're going to run by mission command, that you're taking on a pretty hefty requirement there. Because that means everybody's got to be well-trained. That means everybody has to be well-disciplined. That means all our leaders have to be good leaders. Okay? When I go around the Army, I go around the world and brief this to other armies and even other parts within our military, they're like, wow, now that you put it that way, I don't think we're going to do that in our organization because, you know, we don't have the time, effort, et cetera, like that. Because what does it require you to do? Well, the next two bullets. See, I've solved all your problems for you here. Got them laid out only on one page. You don't have to wade through all 10 pages now. So once you understand the process of understanding, visualize, describe, directly, and assess, the two other things you have to do as a leader is develop teams inside and outside your organization. So you have to develop well-greased teams inside your organization and outside your organization, and inform and influence audiences inside and outside your organization. So you've got to build a very strong team in your organization, the one you're in charge of, and then you've got to take that team if you're going to partner with other teams outside your organization. And then you've got to inform and influence people inside and outside your organization that you're going to have to work with. So, again, if you're the California National Guard, and now you got to go up and deal with a spillway that's eroded away and leaking and stuff like that, California National Guard probably says, well, I got to work with local sheriffs and fire departments and the Forestry Service and Department of Interior, and we're going to get some civil engineers in here. They're going to figure out how we're going to plug the dam. We're going to do all this kind of stuff, and the state of Colorado or the state of California and the local mayors. In other words, there's all kinds of people that I've got to work with that don't work for me. So how do I go as Lieutenant so-and-so, Captain so-and-so, Major so-and-so, Sergeant Major so-and-so, and say, look, here's all these governmental and non-governmental organizations. I don't write their efficiency report. They're not in my chain of command, et cetera, yet. You know, we've got to get along together. We've got to figure out how we're going to, you know, solve this problem. So how do I influence them? Because I really have no levers over them. They don't work for me. They work for other people. I don't control their pay. Well, you know how you gain sort of some leverage over them and influence them? You get a common understanding of the problem, and you describe your visualization of them. Say, look, here's what we're here for. We've got these trucks. We've got, you know, inflatable boats. We can do this. We can do this. This is what I can do. I think, you know, this is my role. What are you going to do? Well, here's what we're going to do. We're the Red Cross, and we're going to set up shelters. We're going to do this. Okay, I understand that visualization. Let's work together, et cetera, like that. Because that's, how you influence people. Under command and control, how did you influence people? You control compliance with your command. But what if you aren't in a position to command them? What if they don't work for you? That's a problem. But see, in the Army I grew up, if you looked at the Cold War, we weren't talking about working with NGOs and humanitarian organizations, something like that. We were only really talking about working with people that we command, okay? But now what we're seeing is when we send people to Afghanistan, Iraq, humanitarian disasters, everything like that, you have to work with all kinds of people that you have no authority to command whatsoever. Yet you still have to influence them. So I found the best way to influence them is create a common understanding of the problem and a visualization of how you're going to solve it. Because in the end, that's probably one of the most powerful ways to influence somebody. Because if you have now shaped how they see the world, you have shaped how they understand the problem, and they have the common visualization of you, that's the ultimate form of control. That's like mind control, right? Because you've shaped how they see the problem. Now, don't say, hey, yeah, the Army's this new thing, mind control. We don't need that headline. But in essence, that's a much longer term process of influence than just, hey, go to A, move from A to B. When you get to B, give me a call, let me know, because I want you to comply with my command. You're having to now sort of paint this bigger picture. What this means is this is a very leader-centric philosophy. This is a very commander leader-centric philosophy, because you have to spend a lot of time describing your visualization to people. You have to spend a lot of time creating common understanding, et cetera, like that. So there's a lot of upfront costs with this. But it pays off, because what you do is you get a lot of upfront costs, but you get a long-term influence even after you've left. Because now you're shaping how they're thinking about things well after you've left the scene. In fact, I'm going to spend a couple hours with you here today, and then after that, I'm going to meet with a bunch of general officers in TRADOC, and what we're going to talk about, you know what, our visualization for the next doctrinal manual. I'm going to talk to them with a whiteboard. I think we've got to do this and this and do this and everything like that. Then I'll get on a plane and leave. My assumption is I will have adequately influenced them with my visualization that they will then sort of move out, and they don't have to send me every word of the manual every day. I don't have to control it, that it's the sort of the manifestation of our visualization is sort of coming to fruition. So what this generally involves, if you're the leader or commander of an organization, there's a lot of upfront work that has to be done, establishing a culture, getting buy-in, creating visualization, understanding, but then your influence extends itself well beyond your physical presence. So you don't have to be everywhere all the time. And the larger the organization you have, the more difficult it is to be everywhere all the time controlling everything. Okay, so this is also, it works on platoons, but then as you get higher and higher in rank, which we think you have great potential to be, or else we wouldn't expend hundreds of thousands of dollars to bring you here, that this is actually becomes more and more important. So the organization I run, Training and Doctrine Command, we're located in 1,634 locations around the world. So how often do you think I visit all 1,634 locations? Not weekly, okay? So you've got to have some way to influence them, to get everyone going in the same direction. Because there will be parts of TRADOC that I will never see, never. But I sort of want them headed in the same direction. So this, we think, is one of the most critical things with regards to the future as we see it. But I just told you this is sort of leader-centric. So if you go to the next slide, so this is a doctrine for our command philosophy. This is our doctrine for leadership. So this is, now, the good news about this is, again, if you wonder where the box is that we have doctrine in, it's right here. If you go, I wonder what manual, if I'm going to develop a leader, should I look at, ADP 622 called Army Leadership. Okay, so we've tried to make this pretty, you know, fault-free. And just like I promised, every manual, I think this, you know, as I said, the guidance was 10 pages, mission command is 12, because all things are possible in the Army with a waiver. This is 622, here's the logic map right here in ADP 622. And we're saying, and there's actually a lot of science behind this, this is what we want our good leaders to be. This is what we want them to look like, because we're saying, because that's the benefit of doing all our doctrine at once and putting in a box, one thing links to another, links to another. So we came up with a command philosophy, mission command, kind of ran you through that. You say, wow, this is very leader-centric. This is a very leader-centric philosophy. Well, just take the next book in the box. And here it is. This is Roadmap to Leadership. Okay? You know, it's on the web. You can download it. We make these right here so we can get you hard copies before you leave out of here. And there's kind of two parts to this. The top part is what we call personal attributes. Okay? This is what I want you to be and know. This is what I want you to be and know. Okay? I want you, okay, to be fit. I want you to know what's required to be an expert in your field. I want you to be resilient. I want you to know how to innovate. Okay? So this is what I want you personally to be and know. These are the personal attributes that I want to see manifested from you. Okay? I want you to be a warrior. I want you to know how to be empathetic. I want you to be disciplined, on and on and on. But we're saying personal attributes in and of themselves are inadequate. You must take your personal attributes that we basically have spent 2 to 4 years developing in you, and then you need to array them in time and space and actually do something with them. Okay? English majors out there can correct me if I'm wrong, but we want you to do something, hence these all start with verbs. I want you to lead others. Lead by example, develop others, prepare yourself, get results. You must get results. The Army is not an altruistic jobs program, contrary to popular belief. You must get results. We're a results-oriented organization. But you must get results while creating a positive command climate. You must get results while making people better. If you get results, but in the process you destroy people, if you get results and destroy your organization, then you're not a good leader. You have to get results at the same time that when you lead that organization, even if it's in the middle of combat, that organization is better for having had you in it. You left the organization better, you left your people better, you developed them, et cetera, et cetera. So you have to have both of these. You have to have personal attributes, and then you have to do something with these attributes we've developed. Well, a very interesting phenomena. In fact, we do it out here at Fort Leavenworth Center for Army Leadership every year. We do a CASL survey, and we take a survey ourselves, our leader development, and we ask corporal to colonel, or E4 to colonel. So I tell folks we really don't care what generals think anymore. So from our E4 to colonels, we say great, and we do it with our civilian cohort as well. Grade us on leadership. How are we the Army doing, and et cetera, like that. And very interesting feedback we got. So last year, I think we got like 30,000 respondents, E4 to colonel. And there's one answer that I actually find pretty interesting as I read through. In fact, I'm going to talk about it with the folks today and usually near the end. It kind of says, describe to me the best leader you've ever worked for. You know, describe to me the best leader you've ever worked for. So if you're a sergeant, maybe it's a staff sergeant. If you're a lieutenant, maybe it's a captain or whatever. Now, the interesting part about this is I know that most people in the Army, and I don't take it personally, most people in the Army, unlike you all, don't read doctrine every night. Most people in the Army, unlike you all, have not memorized this. Most people like you, unlike you all, they don't even know we have a manual on leadership. They don't even know we have a manual. They're clueless, let alone that we have attributes and competencies and all that. They have no idea that we have a paradigm of our model of leadership, et cetera, like that, and that we're going to take their answers and kind of parse it out and put it into this category and that category. They actually think when we ask them the question, we just want to know what they think. They don't think that we're going to kind of overly analyze this, which actually makes their answers all the more interesting. Because they don't even know that there's a right answer or wrong answer. They just think, well, I guess you really want to know what I think. So I'll tell you what I think. Here, my best leader I've ever worked for is XYZ. What's interesting is without them even knowing there are categories, most of the answers come down in one category. What do you think that is? If you just I'd take 30,000 random people in the Army and say, describe the best leader you've worked for in your own words. And the majority of the answers come down in one category. What do you think that category is? It's competencies. Competencies. In other words, what do you do? What they're saying is, I don't really care if you're the smartest person in the organization. I just want to know, are you developing others? Okay. I don't care if you have the highest PT score. I just want to know, are you building trust? Are you leading others? Now, we know from experience and science and all that, that you have to have threshold level capabilities of this. If you are not fit, you cannot lead others, okay? If you are not values-based, it's hard to build trust. So you have to have threshold levels of these. But what our subordinates grade us on is what do you do with them? What are you doing with your attributes? Actually, it was kind of an eye-opener. A couple years ago, one of the headlines coming out of CASL was, in Army Times, we have too much toxic leadership in the Army, micromanagement, whatever, like that. We're like, well, how could that be? Well, let's think about it. As you've been going through, we look back and say, well, let's take a look at this. As we look at when we were putting folks through West Point or ROTC or any of our non-commissioned officer education systems, what did we usually grade you on? Attributes. What's your GPA? What's your PT score? What's your rifle score? What's your this? What's your that? Even our OER NCOER systems were very heavily focused on attributes. And then we're sitting there, gosh, if we're focusing a lot on the individual person, why is it that we have such self-centered and self-serving people in the Army? How could that possibly be? Maybe because that's all we were measuring. Okay? But what were our subordinates measuring us on? What did we do? Okay, not how smart we were or how much we impressed our boss. What did we do for what did we do for the unit? Develop others, lead from the front, build trust. So you know what we did? We changed our doctrine. You know what we did? We changed our OERs. We changed our NCORs. We changed what we do in professional military education. It's not one at the expense of the other. It's you've got to have the whole package there. But we started focusing more on this because that's what your subordinates are going to grade you on. What do you do and why do you do it? What's your motivation? Is it for your own personal advancement or is it to develop others? Is it to make you look good, okay? Or is it to build trust with inside the organization? That's very important. So I just want to run through these two big macro slides because this is sort of all about leadership and to say, well, guess what? The Army's kind of thought through this. We have a philosophy of leadership and we have doctrine on leadership. And it is based on the world as we see it now and where we think the world is going. So we didn't just sort of lay in bed and think just sort of random thoughts or pick up the latest management book or something like this. We kind of laid it out and said, we need a certain kind of leadership in the Army to do what? And then we had to figure out what the what is. So if you are going to go into an organization that deals with a finite set of problems, if you're going into an organization that's deal with a very well-known problem set, you have well-prescribed detailed tactics, techniques, and procedures in dealing with it, this may not be the philosophy for that organization. I was at on Friday at Georgetown University and talking to some students and kind of explained a little bit longer process of it, why the Army is doing what we're doing. And it's the product of a deliberate thought process coming to grips with what we think the future of the world is so that when we develop lieutenants and sergeants, they are prepared to lead in that world. And so my advice to any organization is if you are trying to decide how you run your organization, how you're going to lead it or whatever, you have to come to grips with what is the environment that organization is going to operate in. How much do you want to empower people? How disciplined are they? How much are you going to invest in your people? The Army invests more than any other service and probably more than any other Army in the world. We invest more in leader development than anybody else. So depends how long you've been in ROTC. Could be up to 4 years. West Point, 4 years. Okay. Then we're going to send you to BOLIC. And then you may go to some functional training, Ranger School, Airborne School, whatever. You may go to flight school. Then you go off for a while. They're going to bring you back and go to the Captain's Career Course. Then you go off for a while. They're going to bring you back to this great facility, Command General Staff College. And then you'll come back, go off for a while. They won't bring you back to War College. And then when you're a general, we have 36 latest now general officer courses that we put our generals through, one star through four star. So we spend a huge amount of time and effort developing you all, more than anybody else, and it costs us hundreds of millions of dollars to do it. But we've decided we have to do that because we want to empower people, which means they have to be well-led, which means we have to have folks like you. Hey, what I'd like to do right now is just open up for questions. Can be about anything, doesn't have to be about this. Been around the Army a long time. Trade doctors does about everything in the Army. Yeah. In the back there. Well, the good news is in our sort of constitutional processes, we are a sort of nations of institutions and laws, and so a lot of what we do is prescribed in law by constitution, so there's a certain amount of continuity that goes through it. Probably the biggest change the Army is, and because of TRADOC as well, is probably in the middle of right now. So every year there's a National Defense Authorization Act that gets signed by Congress that determines the size of the Army, amongst other things. It does a lot of things, but it determines the size of it. Until, I think this one was signed in January by the President. The Army, from an active duty and strength, we were headed to 450,000. The last NDA that just signed has us going to 476,000. So that's an increase of 26,000 people. So that's a pretty dramatic difference in the number of people at the end of the day, so to speak. That'll have a lot of impact across the Army, because then one of the discussions you have is, what do you do with those people? Do you form other units, et cetera, like that? The immediate impact on TRADOC with regards to increasing the end strength is, one of the things TRADOC does for our Army is we run recruiting command. So, okay, we recruit the Army. So when you drive across the United States, you can see a strip mall and says Armed Forces Recruiting, go, hey, that's training and doctrine command. So our initial impact to TRADOC is we have a huge recruiting bill, okay? So if you got any friends that are interested in the Army, I'll hook them up with your local recruiter. But it doesn't just end there. So say once we recruit the Army, what's the next thing you have to do with the people you recruit? You got to train them, okay? So the TRADOC runs basic training. We run BOLIC. We run all that stuff. So now I've got to increase my capacity for basic training, AIT, all the functional training. So I've got to increase my capacity to recruit. Then I got to recruit more people. I got to increase my capacity to train. Then I got to train more people. So that's a very immediate impact that I'm dealing with right now. That's a pretty short turnaround. Because one of the things that I constantly remind folks is, when you, and most generals don't know this, so you're already a leg up. When I talk about the United States Army, even within our joint services and around the world, the first word I mention is scale. The United States Army does things to scale that nobody else does. So people are always coming out to me, and again, we're a professional organization, so we're looking for good ideas. Hey, General Perkins, why doesn't the Army do this? Dave, why don't you do that? I'm like, well, all right, I'll take a look at it, but it's got to scale. I have to be able to scale it. So I said, we're a total force, 1.2 million people. We're in a talent management. Talent management is new vogue, and we talk about it a lot. And I was at a human resource council talent management conference with a lot of Fortune 500 companies, everything like that. And TRADOC is a proponent for leader development in our Army. And they said, one guy said, hey, our CEO is really into talent management and all that. He interviews everybody we hire coming in the company and gets to understand their background to put a round peg in a round hole to make sure we got a good fit and everything. I said, wow, that's pretty interesting. So do anybody here know how many people last year, 2016, the United States Army recruited active Guard and Reserve? We recruited 134,000 people. That's over 11,000 people a month. So we'll just round it up. So when you talk about like new hires, the Army hires 10,000 people a month. So I said, well, gosh, if the Chief of Staff of the Army is going to interview everybody we hire, he's going to have to get on it. And if he takes 30 days off, that's 20,000 people he's going to interview next year. So just think about that. What if you ran an organization that hired 10,000 people a month? Every month. Okay, and I was at a Chief of Defense conference in Africa last year, and in Senegal. I was talking to the Senegalese Chief of Staff of the Army, which has a great army. He's a great professional himself, and they have compulsory service there, so everyone in the country has to be there. He's talking about, what does TRADOC do, or stuff like that. We do this, we do that. And I said, one of the things we do is recruit the Army. We run recruiting command. He goes, oh, really? What's recruiting? Because if you have compulsory service, like I said, well, that's where we go and get people to voluntarily join the Army in a time of war. Really? Doesn't everybody in the U.S. have to serve in the Army? No. In fact, almost nobody does, relatively speaking. 400,000 out of 350 million, that's basically nobody. He said, well, how many people do you recruit? So I rounded off. I said, well, like 10,000 a month. His whole army is 4,000 people. Okay, that's 2.5 of his armies every month. We recruit 2.5 of his armies every month. It's like, holy cow. Like, 2.5 of my armies, like, every month. Like, where do you start? Is it at the beginning of the month? And then we train those people, okay? We train basic, I'll just talk basic training, not even officer training. So we do basic training in four locations, Jackson, Benning, Fort Leonard Wood, and Fort Sill. Last year at Fort Jackson alone, we put about 60,000 people through basic training. 60,000 people through base training in one of four posts, okay? That's close to the size of the British Army. I think the British Army is about 80,000 people now. That's like almost the entire British Army going through basic training in one post every year. Okay, last year we put all kinds of people through TRADOC, you know, Command General Staff College, Ranger School, Airborne School, BOLIC, basic training, AIT, something like that. Last year, I think we put 527,000 people went through TRADOC doing one thing or another, okay, in one year. That's like taking the entire British Army, the entire French Army, and the entire German Army and multiply by two. Entire British Army, French Army, Germany, multiply by two and put them in TRADOC in one year. So see, we do things to scale that most people can't even comprehend, that most people in the Army don't comprehend. So long answer to short question, the first impact we have is that we've got to grow in the Army, you know, an end strength headed to 26,000 people more than we thought, which is larger than a vast number of armies in the world. And we got to do that by October. So we're cranking out recruits and we're working at basic training and everything like that. I just say that scale thing so that when you get out into the Army, sometimes you sit there, you know, I don't know why the Army does this. It's so stupid. Why don't they just do this? Why doesn't the chief of staff just interview everybody we hire? It'd be so much better, et cetera, like that. Just whenever you get those great ideas, don't let go of them, but just say, can I take this great idea and can I do it 10,000 times a month? Because see, if the great idea can't be replicated 10,000 times a month, it's not a good idea for the Army. It might be a good idea for somebody else. It's just not a good idea for the Army because it doesn't scale. It won't scale up. Other questions? Good question. Right here. Yeah.
Talk about your strategy for it.
Yeah.
And then talk specifically to what a lieutenant can do to facilitate that strategy.
Yeah, that's an excellent question. Now, there's when you get a big group of folks like this and talk through stuff, there are three types of questions you can get. There are stupid questions. But everyone says, there's no such thing as a stupid question. Believe me, I get them every day. So there are such things as a stupid question. I don't think we'll get one from here, so I don't want to quash your questions. But there is definitely such a thing as a dumb question. The second kind of question is there are like really good questions. Really good questions that what they generally do is they're very substantive. There's a level of maybe conflict within the question or the answer. Not everybody agrees upon it. It's sort of far-reaching, sort of like that. And then the third level is there are excellent questions. Excellent questions are questions that I already have a backup slide made for, okay? That's an excellent question. If you could put up the multi-domain slide. So not only have we thought about it, but actually we have a strategy. So our Army is a concept-based, doctrine-driven Army. See, excellent question. So I just showed you doctrine. Doctrine is how you run the Army today. So you can pick up any doctrinal manual and you can do what's in it with the organizations and people and equipment that you have today. But concepts change the Army for the future. Okay, concepts change the Army for the future. So this is the Army operating concept, affectionately known as TRADOC 525-3-1. But I know you all knew that. As I said, that changes the Army for the future. And what concepts do is they describe the future. What's the enemy going to do with it, as you said? And then what are our first order capabilities we have to have to get after the enemy? So Army Operating Concept Chapter 2, all about what we call the operating environment. What is our best guess, sir, to your point? What is our best guess? What's the enemy going to do? Who is it, et cetera, like that? So we avoid predicting the enemy in what we do now, because in a known world, we predict them. Now, in an unknown world, we describe them. What is the enemy going to do to us? What we have determined by looking at either, you know, what's going on in the Ukraine, what has happened in Syria, what other near-peer competitors are doing around the world, is a couple of things you're focusing on. One, So all the people that we think are in that category of adversaries or potential adversaries, they really try to do three things to us. One is anti-access air denial. Keep us away from the area of operations. They have seen, whether it's Desert Storm or Iraqi Freedom or whatever, once the U.S. military gets into the area of operations, it's very difficult to get them out, even if they want to leave themselves. They just keep bringing in piles of mountain and stuff like that, and it's very hard to extract them. The second thing is, when they look at our military, et cetera, they're trying to sort of fracture what I call alien battle, the doctrine I grew up with, our ability to pull various aspects of the combined arms team together. They try to fracture it and fragment it. And then the last thing is they try to fix the U.S. Army, particularly the military. Do not let them maneuver, because that's our strength. Maneuver means you take all the elements of combat power, you array them in time and space to get to a position of relative advantage. That's how we fight outnumbered and win. That's how we fight in a way game, which is our plan. We think if we go to war, it will be in a way game. It'll be OCONUS. We very well may be outnumbered because it's in their backyard. So what we're going to do is we're going to maneuver. And we define maneuver as taking all elements of combat power, which are the six warfighting functions, along with information and leadership. Yes, the United States Army maneuvers leadership on the battlefield, not just artillery pieces. We maneuver leadership to get to a position of relative advantage so we can exploit the initiative. And our enemy knows that. And so they want to fix us. They want to take freedom of action away so that we can't, so that we keep everything non-mutually supportive. So what we're going to do is, with our new doctrine, when I grew up, our concept was air-land battle. A couple years ago, we had air-sea battle. So air-land battle, two domains. Air-sea battle, two domains. We said, I call you and I'll raise you. We're doing multi-domain battle. And the intent is to regain freedom of maneuver. But as we look at weapon systems around the world, since they're trying to keep us at arm's length, et cetera, like that, we're seeing increased range and lethality. We're saying we don't want to just go head-to-head, tank-to-tank, artillery-to-artillery, jet-fighter-to-jet-fighter. What we want to do is take all of the domains, multi-domains, and create windows of domain superiority such that I can get a position of relative advantage. So I am going to take cyber, electronic warfare, air, maritime, et cetera, and I'm going to synchronize them at my time and choosing to create a window of domain superiority. When I grew up, we had air-land battle, which was kind of start on one side of the continent and sweep it across, very linear approach. We're saying that's not going to work for the future because of what our enemy is trying to do with regards to integrated air defense and all those things. So we have to be able to create these windows of domain superiority and maneuver superiority of domain around the battlefield, maybe then maneuvering only large land forces. So I might do something in cyber, okay, which facilitates an advantage on land that I follow up with that opens a window for air. So now you're looking at a very different process to execute mission command. You're looking at a different level of situational understanding and a different level of training. Because now, when a platoon leader comes in the Army, as we do this, you know, if they're an infantry platoon leader, they need to know about max effective range of their weapons, et cetera, like that. But they have to now understand the domain of cyber, at least from the point of view of how do they access it? What can it provide to them? We just stood up cyber branch last year. It's a branch in the Army. Any of you commissioned? Any cyber folks? Yeah, cyber. Okay. So it's probably a bigger deal than anything. When is the last time the Army stood up a branch? When's the cyber? But before cyber. The last time we stood up a branch was Special Forces. You know what year that was? Yeah, 1985. So we only do this like every 30 years. Okay. And before that was aviation, 1983. So we don't create branches very often, so we just create a new branch like every 30 years. We have a branch that's an entire domain, cyber. Why? Because we have a new concept of multi-domain, and now I need cyber warriors. I need people that can maneuver in cyber, just like I have people that can maneuver on land. But now, how do I pull this all together? Well, I told you, concepts are about change. So now we are saying, okay, so what does an infantry platoon have to have for cyber? What's the material we have to have? What's the doctrine? In fact, I was just talking with General Lundy on the way down here. We're looking at cyber doctrine. We have to have a .mil PF solution. So the good thing for you all is you are just coming into the Army now as we're laying out this new operating concept that we don't do very often. The last big one we had was Early in Battle, which was published in 1983, okay? So that's what I came in the Army. This is multi-domain battle. You're just coming in the Army as we're laying this out there, and we're going to work our way through it. We've established a new branch. We have new doctrine. We're now looking at new organizations, .mil PF, organizations, materiel, et cetera. So this is big hand, little map, our idea of the future. It's, you know, we put it out in October. So it's, you know, it's in a whole, you know, whatever, 4 or 5 months old. But it's a great time to be coming in the Army, especially going to PME, because you kind of be on the cutting edge of it. So again, excellent question. Other question? Yeah, right. A last official question. Let's see. Anybody in the back? Way in the back, right there. Yeah. Yeah. You mean to the more sort of conventional peer-to-peer stuff? Yeah. Well, as a matter of fact, in many ways, multi-domain battle is sort of based on that. In other words, we took a look at what the Russians did and Russian-supported separatist forces in Ukraine and Crimea. We've taken a look at what's going on in the South China Sea, et cetera, like that. And this is really an answer to that. They were saying, look, if we're going to go to a peer-to-peer competitor, we probably have to get beyond just tank-on-tank, artillery-on-artillery. And so this is multi-domain battle. One of the things we're looking at, the cross-domain fires, if we have that slide somewhere back there. So what we're saying is, one of the ways, really, war is a battle of asymmetries. We're always trying to get an asymmetric advantage. Now, asymmetric is always seen as bad for nation states, like we have a tank, so an asymmetric threat's like an IED or something. That's true because it's coming at us from a different angle. But we're always trying to get asymmetry on them. So we have multi-domain battle, and now when TRADOC does a big operating concept, then we do functional concepts underneath that. So you have sustainment, fires, maneuver. In fact, I got a meeting this afternoon on the maneuver concept. So our fires concept is cross-domain fires. So right now, our pretty much the way our fires... who's going artillery? Anyone here artillery? Who's going ADA? Okay, so we got fires, folks out there. So right now we kind of see as artillery is land to land, that domain to that domain. Air defense is land to air defense. What we're saying is, what if I had a fires battery that was multi-domain? What if I had a fires battery capability that could go land to land? What if I had a fires battery that had anti-ship missiles on it? So what if I had a U.S. Army fires battery that had missiles that can operate in the maritime domain? Okay, so if I'm in the South China Sea and I'm an adversary there, the U.S. Army could take some of its anti-ship missiles and put them on the proverbial unsinkable ship, otherwise known as land, and now put an adversary's navy at risk. Now that Navy doesn't always only have to worry about the U.S. Navy. That Navy has to worry about the United States Army, because the Army might have anti-ship missiles on a land-based fires capability. What if on that same fires capability you had long-range precision fires like hundreds of kilometers? What if you could take down unmanned aerial systems, et cetera? So see, when you talk about multi-domain battle, that's a pretty inclusive thing. And then you start looking at the functional domains. I just have this one up here, cross-domain fires. A United States Army fires capability really now is getting an asymmetric threat on other domains, okay? Because if you're going to fire if you have a fire escape ability from land to land, if you want to fire from land to sea, the physics is not that much different. You know, the relative humidity of the point of impact doesn't really affect the flight of the munition that much. And oh, by the way, ships really don't go that fast, even a fast ship at 35, 40 knots, and they're pretty big targets. Okay, and it's a pretty capital intensive investment. And so if you had Army's fire batteries ringing the shoreline of places, which are very hard to detect, you have now put your enemy in a dilemma. You now have what we'd call a relative position of advantage, because it's going to be very hard for them to maneuver. So we're working on multi-domain battle, and then we have all the functional concepts underneath that. Folks, I just want to wrap up with one last thing. Because I said, if you want to execute mission command, you have to have a well-trained, well-disciplined, very professional force. You have to have a very professional force. So if you can put up the slide on the Army profession, okay, ADRP 10, okay, it's in your box. Let me give you some advice on this. A lot of times you go to your unit, you have all this mandatory training. We got to do, you know, we got to weapons qualification, we got to do this, we got to qualify on this, you got to do quarterly training on that. Do not look at the Army profession as mandatory training. Well, I have to do my quarterly profession thing, check the blocks, move out. Think of it as the essence of who you are. Okay, think of it the essence of who you are. And this was made very clear to me from somebody who's not even in the Army, he's not even an American. So I was an infantry division commander in Iraq, and was traveling with not even a counterpart, somebody else ranked me quite a bit. And we're going around doing our thing, and one day at lunch we're talking, and you know Americans are, well, we could do this, we could do that, we could do this, and apparently I did reach the official good idea cutoff point. He said, "Wait a minute." He says, "You know, hey General, I've been watching you operate your division here for a couple of months, et cetera, like that." And he says, "I can see the way you operate that you take being a general in the American Army for granted." Well, that's an interesting comment. He says, "Yeah, I've been watching you, and you take being a general in the American Army for granted." And I said, "What? You're questioning the effectiveness of a promotion system that would select somebody like me to be a general officer? Get in line." He goes, No, you know, not questioning your effectiveness or anything like that. He says, you're just a very naive man. You're a very naive person. He says, because you trust everybody. He says, the way I see you operate, you're very naive. You're very unnecessarily trusting. Because you'll get in your fancy helicopter and you'll fly up north and you'll tell 1st Brigade to do something and then you leave and you don't worry about them establishing a coup. You go down to 3rd Brigade, you give them brand new MRAPs, you don't worry that when you leave they're going to sell them on the black market. You go tell the Sergeant Major something, you don't worry that when he leaves he's going to call his cousin and the Minister of Defense and get you relieved. He says, you just trust that everyone's going to do what you say. And I kind of paused for a moment. I said, you know what, he's actually right. He's absolutely right. I don't worry about 1st Brigade starting a coup. I don't worry about 3rd Brigade selling their MRAPs. 4th Brigade, I keep my eye on, but I got reasons. And he said, you know, the other thing is, he says, you know, I've watched your unit, and, you know, your unit is not a zero defect unit. Bad things happen in your unit. People don't know what they're maybe supposed to be doing. But he said, the difference is, in your unit, if a lieutenant doesn't know what he or she is doing, the platoon sergeant steps in and helps him out, or the company commander does. If a private's not sure what's going on, a sergeant comes in. So what happens is, if something's not going right in your unit, somebody from the chain of command kind of gets things right. He says, you don't understand, in my Army, if I'm not there, nothing happens. You know, by the way, Perkins, this happens and you're nowhere to be found. You're nowhere to be found. All kinds of things are getting fixed and you're not around. Because what he was saying is, in my Army, if I'm not there, nothing happens. Nothing gets fixed. And then he didn't use this word here. He says, but I notice your soldiers have this sense that they're about something larger than themselves. In fact, their worst fear is they would let the person to the left and right of them down, that they would sort of, you know, disgrace them. Not that they would get injured, but that they would let somebody down. He says, so there's a certain whatever, you know, we call esprit de corps. But actually, in our Army, we have a definition of esprit de corps. TRADOC defines everything doctrinally. Esprit de corps has nothing to do with t-shirts and company runs. Now, I have a lot of unit t-shirts. I love company runs. That's a manifestation of esprit de corps. But we define esprit de corps as a jealous regard for the honor of your unit. A jealous regard for the honor of your unit. Are your actions in keeping with something that would bring honor to your unit? If we don't say, just think about it, keep it in the back of your mind, we're saying a jealous regard. So if somebody comes to me and says, oh, sir, you know, we have bad morale in my unit, we don't like the commander, I don't like that, horrible esprit de corps. I say, really? So you're acting dishonorably? What? Yeah, because see, esprit de corps has nothing to do external, it's all internal. In other words, esprit de corps is your manifestation of the way you want to act so that your actions reflect honor on your unit. And I tell folks that's this unit, and this unit. Because see, when you wear this uniform, you get associated with a whole lot. And as you travel around the world, people look at you and they look at your actions and they judge this, and they judge this. So it's a huge responsibility when we put one of these on you and make you an officer, because we're saying this is the manifestation of the standards of the United States of America and the United States Army. And then therefore, we are going to allow you to judge our nation and our Army based on you. Because we're saying we know they are acting honorably. We take it for granted. I told you that general said, I take being a general in the Army for granted. I do. And I take it for granted that you're one of your greatest desires is to honor the uniform that you're wearing. He said, the other thing is, and it did happen to be an artillery unit. He says, I was up north. You had this unit, artillery. One day is doing counterinsurgency operations, a very complex task in and of itself. Then the next day, started firing artillery over dismounted infantry, combined arms live fire. Again, one complex task. The next day, switched to another complex task. And in fact, again, Perkins, you were nowhere to be found. I don't really know what you do. All kinds of stuff going on. You're hardly ever there. In fact, there were hardly any officers there. It was mainly non-commissioned officers doing it. And then he said this right here. He says, where do you get soldiers who will travel thousands of miles away from home and possibly give their lives for people they don't even know when I can't even get my own army to defend its own country? So what he was saying is, Perkins, I don't need a lecture from you because you're not really that good. You're not really that good. Because if I had one of these, I'd be twice the division commander you are. In fact, what he was saying is, how hard can it be to command an infantry division in the United States Army? If you got an infantry division full of this, it just can't be that hard. You just have to show up for work. What he was saying is, Perkins, you have a big problem. You have a big problem. You have a huge crutch because you lean on this every day. He says, I see how you operate, and you just assume you have an infantry division full of these. And he's absolutely right. I do have a huge crutch. I assume all of my subordinates are professionals. I never question their motivation. And I'm always trying to figure out how to empower them versus control them. So he was very, very intuitive. He says, in fact, this whole thing's been a giant bait and switch. Because you Americans came over here and you sold us your tanks and your Humvees and your rifles, et cetera, like that. But they don't do anything. They just sit there in the motor pool and rust. You know why? Because you didn't sell us this. You didn't sell us this. That's the secret ingredient. You know what? If you look in the foreign military sales catalog, it ain't for sale. The reason it's not for sale is because it's a do-it-yourself project. It's a do-it-yourself project. You have to build it within. You can't buy professionalism. Now, the good thing is you can't buy it, but you can't steal it either. So we don't have to worry about some rogue nation hacking into our professionalism. They can't steal it on a thumb drive. They can steal the plans for a Joint Strike Fighter, you know, on our thumb drive. You can hack into the software, the control system, something like that. But they can't steal your professionalism because you have to make it yourself. It comes from within. And we've been at this a long time. Okay, this June will be 242 years, the 242nd birthday of the United States Army. And as I constantly remind folks, the birthday of the United States Army is 14 June 1775. The birthday of our country is 4 July 1776. The United States Army is older than the United States of America. The army that we're going to commission you into and the soldiers that you will lead is older than the republic you defend. That's a huge responsibility that we're putting in your rucksack. Because we're not just giving you a platoon, we're giving you an institution that is older than the country itself and is primarily responsible for the birth of our nation and the sustainment of our way of life. And do you know how you build a professionalism that's the envy of the world? Soldier by soldier, sergeant by sergeant, lieutenant by lieutenant. Problem is, it's taken us 242 years to build it. You know how quickly you lose it? About that quickly. And you know how you lose it? Soldier by soldier, sergeant by sergeant, lieutenant by lieutenant. So if you want to know what you are for when we commission you and put you in the Army, this. You are a steward of this profession. We are handing you off a 242-year-old, handmade, envy of the world institution that really our way of life depends upon. And when we look at other armies around the world that we've spent lots of time with and things didn't go well when they were put under pressure, people go, well, what? Were they well-trained? Weren't they well-trained? They were very well-trained. They just weren't very professional. Don't confuse being well-trained with being very professional. You've got to do both. So this is what you are. You're the steward of our profession. And we are now going to give you the next generation of leaders, which will perpetuate this on, hopefully, for another 240 years. So, again, congratulations on being selected amongst your peers. Squeeze every ounce of blood you can out of this rock while you're here. Look forward to serving with you, and thank you for letting me take you for granted. God bless, folks. Ooh.
Okay, we're going to go ahead and move to lunch. Okay, so down the steps and to the right. If anybody requested a special meal, just step aside when you get down to the bottom and they'll make sure they get it to you.